Hello and welcome to the Shock and Sepsis Presentation Lecture for Critical Care Review. My name is Tom DeSanto and I will be narrating this presentation. We're going to discuss topics of shock and sepsis. The objectives of this lecture are to define shock and the types of shock, recognize the presence of shock, identify the causes and treatments of shock, nursing management of patients with shock, and recognize early identification and treatment of sepsis. By definition, shock is the inability of the circulatory system to deliver enough blood to meet the oxygen and metabolic requirements of the body tissues. This results in inadequate tissue perfusion, deprives cells of oxygen, nutrients, and energy. We can break the types of shock down into three major types: cardiogenic, hypovolemic, and distributive. And under distributive shock, there are three types: neurogenic, anaphylactic, and septic. There are stages of shock, and all types of shock activate the sympathetic nervous system, which initiates compensatory mechanisms of shock. When talking about the early signs, you have a decrease in the MAP down about 10 millimeters from baseline. Basically, the body is effective in compensation. The heart rate increases and maintains cardiac output. It progresses then, and you lose about 10 to 15 points from your MAP, and the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system kick in. You release antidiuretic hormone, vasoconstriction starts to occur. Your pulse rate probably would, or your pulse pressure will start to narrow or start to drop. Your heart rate will continue to go up. Your pH will start to go down. You'll start to become restless and apprehensive. As this progresses, you have the progressive signs where the MAP is now down 20 points. Your tissues and oxygen start to become hypoxic. You start to have oliguria or decreased urinary output. You have a weak pulse, thready. Your pH continues to drop. And you start to have sensory neuro changes. Last would be the refractory period, where excessive and extensive cell damage and organ damage occur. You have multi-system organ failure and your pH continues to drop, usually down below 7.15. Shock begins in the initial stage. This is the first cellular changes from the decrease in oxygen delivery and perfusion. Decreased aerobic and increased anaerobic metabolism increases your serum lactic acid levels. Usually there's no obvious clinical signs and symptoms during this stage. Most people can start off a normal infectious process or a disease process in this stage, and their body is able to compensate. As shock progresses, you get to the compensatory stage. Looking at neurological, baroreceptors in the aortic arch and the carotid arteries detect changes in the blood pressure. When this changes, it increases or activates the sympathetic nervous system. Vasoconstriction and peripheral nerve circulation occur, and decreased renal blood flow stimulates the kidneys. You start releasing hormones because of this hit to the kidneys, and you have increased production of catecholamines and ACTH. You have activation of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, which then releases vasopressin, and you start to retain fluid and trigger more vasoconstriction. Chemically, this stimulates respiratory ventilation perfusion imbalances and causes respiratory alkalosis. You have a decreased level of consciousness, you feel tired, increased agitation, and you become restless, and you begin to hyperventilate to compensate. Shock then goes to the progressive stage, which is characterized by at least one end organ failure from prolonged compensatory changes. You start to have severe hypoperfusion, impaired oxygen delivery, and multi-organ dysfunction syndrome, or MODS. GI and renal failure are followed by respiratory and or cardiac failure and loss of liver and cerebral functions. Your body tends to shut down in a very specific order. In the refractory stage, cellular death has progressed and is now irreparable. Complete organ failure and death is imminent from cardiac and or respiratory arrest. When shock gets to this state, it's very difficult to correct. Let's start by discussing cardiogenic shock. Cardiogenic shock has impaired tissue perfusion as a result of severe cardiac dysfunction. The heart has ceased to work as an organ or a pump. Causes are coronary. You have an MI, a ruptured vessel or papillary muscle, or myocardial ischemia. You could have non-coronary specific shock, which is from a tamponade, end-stage heart failure, arrhythmias, or valvular heart disease. Looking at the symptomology of cardiogenic shock, you have a decrease in your stroke volume and cardiac output. This decrease in your cardiac output will lead to a decrease in blood pressure. You'll have an increase in your arterial pressure, an increase in your CVP, an increase in your systemic vascular resistance, and an increase in your PA pressure, and you will get pulmonary edema. This causes confusion and restlessness, shallow rapid respirations, dusky cold extremities, and usually a murmur. Treatment for cardiogenic shock all relies on treating the underlying cause of this cardiogenic shock. We supply or supplement the person's oxygen so that we can actually support them. We will deliver inotropes, such as dobutamine, dopamine, and milnarone to a patient to support their blood pressure or to support their cardiac function, vasopressors to support their blood pressure, diuretics to actually shift fluid out of the interstitial space and bring it intravascularly. And we may need to actually assist their heart in pumping because it's inadequate by inserting an intra-aortic balloon pump or a vascular assist device. Next, we discuss hypovolemic shock. Hypovolemic shock is impaired tissue perfusion resulting from severely diminished circulating blood volume. The causes of hypovolemic shock can be external, such as hemorrhaging of blood, plasma, or body fluids, GI tract from vomiting, diarrhea, and suctioning, and renal from overuse of diuretics, diabetes insipidus, or Addison's disease. You could have internal hemorrhaging or buildup of fluid into the interstitial space that causes intravascular dehydration as well. Symptoms include decreased stroke volume and cardiac output due to low circulating volume, decreased blood pressure and tissue perfusion, increased heart rate, anxiety, inability to concentrate, tachypnea, decreased level of consciousness, pale gray skin, cool extremities with poor capillary refill, and decreased urinary output. To treat hypovolemic shock, you need to identify the source and stop the bleeding or stop the fluid loss. We need to manage electrolytes because shunting all that fluid around the body tends to disrupt the electrolyte balances in the body. And we need to administer fluid volume expanders or blood products to compensate for that loss of fluid or intravascular volume. Next, we would discuss distributive shock, and we'll start with neurogenic. Neurogenic shock is an impaired tissue perfusion caused by damage or dysfunction to the sympathetic nervous system. Usually, this is caused by trauma or spinal cord injuries, or even by anesthesia. The symptoms are usually profound hypotension and bradycardia. decreased central venous pressures or preload, decreased systemic vascular resistance or afterload, pulmonary artery occlusive pressure is low, your cardiac output and cardiac index are all low. In neurogenic shock, all of your numbers are low. You have hypothermia or hyperthermia, depending on the causative factor. Causes restlessness and confusion. You get warm, dry skin, paralysis, apnea, and tachypnea. Treating neurogenic shock is identify and remove the causes that are actually precipitating this neurogenic event. Intubation is sometimes warranted. For hypotension, we give fluids or we administer vasopressors. For the hypothermia, we warm fluids. We give warm blankets. Use a bear hugger. We sometimes will use steroids or atropine. We provide respiratory support either through nasal cannula, non-rebreather, or even ventilation assistance through intubation. And we maintain immobilization so as to not overstimulate the sympathetic nervous system. The next type of shock we would discuss would be anaphylactic. Anaphylactic shock is the impaired tissue perfusion resulting from an antigen-antibody reaction that causes histamine to be released into the bloodstream. Causes could be anything from medication, food, snake bites or snake bite venom, insect bites or bee stings, contrast media, blood transfusion. Anything that contains an antigen or a protein body can precipitate an anaphylactic reaction. The symptoms of anaphylactic shock include tissue edema, hives, flushed warm skin, chills, anxiety, confusion, and headache. These people will usually have difficulty breathing. They can have stridor if the upper airway is affected, tachypnea or shortness of breath, wheezing, GI cramps, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, increased heart rate, and decreased blood pressure. Treatment is to remove the antigen. Unfortunately, this is not always possible, especially if this is ingestion. Once the protein or that antigen is ingested, the body has to clear it. We provide the antidote, if at all possible, or we supply antihistamines, steroids, and if we need to, epinephrine. When we look at shock and we look at the hemodynamic parameters that are affected, if we look at cardiogenic shock, the cardiac index goes down, systemic vascular resistance goes up, and the pulmonary artery occlusive pressure goes up. With hypovolemic shock, the cardiac index drops, systemic vascular resistance goes up, and the pulmonary artery occlusive pressure goes down. With distributive shocks, cardiac index will go up, systemic vascular resistance will go down, and pulmonary artery occlusive pressure will either stay the same or drop. Obstructive shock, cardiac index will go down, systemic vascular resistance will go up, and the pulmonary artery occlusive pressure will go up. Next, we're going to discuss sepsis and the treatments of sepsis. Sepsis affects more than 750,000 people annually, with over 2,000 new cases each day in the United States. At the moment, it is the 10th leading cause of death in the United States. 215,000 people die each year, with a mortality rate between 28 and 50%. It is the number one cause of death in the ICU. It's present in 6.3% of all patients admitted to the ICU. Sepsis costs $17 billion annually. Sepsis is a paradigm, which means that it goes down a cascade that follows a general pattern. And although the time length of this pattern can vary, the steps of this sepsis cascade are pretty straightforward. You have a systemic inflammatory response. You begin with sepsis that translates into severe sepsis, septic shock, and then multi-organ dysfunction. Some of the common causes of sepsis include respiratory tract infections, intra-abdominal and pelvic site infections, urinary tract infections, skin infections, intravascular catheters. These common infection sites are usually infected with fairly common organisms such as E. coli, Klebsiella, Citronobacter, Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Predisposing factors for sepsis include patients of extreme age, whether very, very young or very, very old. Severe burns for skin integrity issues, recent traumas, recent surgical procedures where the skin integrity has been broken, and invasive procedures. Anyone who's immunosuppressed for any reason, whether that be by steroid use or through an autoimmune disorder. Malnutrition will affect people's ability to fight off infection, which can leave them more vulnerable to sepsis. Alcohol use and abuse can cause susceptibility to sepsis. And sepsis in general creates a prolonged ICU stay. As I stated previously, sepsis follows a paradigm, and this paradigm is represented here. It starts with a systemic inflammatory response, in which case you will have indicators of sepsis, whether that be a temperature greater than 38 degrees or under 36 degrees Celsius, a heart rate over 90, respiratory rate greater than 20, a PaCO2 less than 32, white blood cell count greater than 12,000 or lower than 4,000, or more than 10% bandemia. It's important to understand that these parameters trigger someone in our charting system and alert us to a possible sepsis alert. To progress to sepsis, a source of infection and two Sears criteria must be met. To be in severe sepsis, one would need to be in fulminant sepsis, which is two of the Sears criteria, an identified source of infection, and evidence of organ damage, whether that would be renal function impairment by oliguria or decreased cardiac output or respiratory issues by ABG. Severe sepsis and septic shock then progress and become septic shock. That is an organ dysfunction in the presence of persistence of hypotension. We're going to explore these stages in detail. Systemic events that occur in response to an insult to the body initiate an inflammatory response and an immune response, triggering systemic inflammatory response syndrome. It is an inflammatory process that increases vasodilation and capillary permeability. Basically, the blood starts leaking into the capillary beds and into the endothelial tissue, causing damage. You have microclot formation and widespread microvascular thrombi throughout the body, which impairs circulation even further. This progresses to sepsis, which is generalized as an inflammatory response that is manifested by two or more of the conditions that define systemic inflammatory response syndrome. That's a temperature over 100.4 or 38 degrees C, or below 96.8 degrees or 36 degrees C. The heart rate would be over 90, respiratory rate greater than 20 breaths per minute, and a white blood cell count greater than 12,000 or under 4,000, or bands greater than 10%. I wish to make note here that you should be careful when taking vital signs or when recording vital signs that are provided either by a tech or by someone that's been delegated the task for doing vital signs. Confirming a respiratory rate that's close to 20 or at 20 would be imperative for someone in a hospital, especially who would be at risk for developing sepsis. So be very careful when recording your vital signs. Severe sepsis is the progression of sepsis to cellular dysfunction and organ damage and organ hypoperfusion. Due to hyperperfusion and microvascular thrombi, you have a progression to severe sepsis. Signs and symptoms are cardiovascular. You would begin to be hypotensive, tachycardic, and poor capillary refill. This is from fluid shifting out of the intravascular space and into the extracellular, into the extravascular space. You would get tachypneic and hypoxemia because of increased oxygen demand of the tissues. You'd have decreased urinary output due to decreased cardiac output. Hematologic, you would have decreased platelets, elevated neutrophils, and altered white blood cell counts. Neurologically, your mental status would be altered, and you would have chills, modeling, and decreased skin perfusion due to this capillary bed dilatation. Septic shock is persistent hypotension and perfusion abnormalities progressing from severe sepsis. It leads to multi-organ dysfunction. The presence of progressive dysfunction in two or more organ systems creates this septic shock syndrome. The primary organ system is directly an effect of a result or an insult to that organ that has been compromised. And secondary is an organ that is now affected by the first organ's failure. Mortality rate once you reach septic shock and multi-organ dysfunction is between 50 and 100% as the number of involved organs increases. To treat sepsis, we need to identify it early on, and we need to start treating the underlying causes. We need to prevent the progression of shock to organ failure, maximize our oxygen delivery to cardiac and to improve cardiac output, decrease oxygen demand, and initiate the surviving sepsis bundle. The sepsis bundle starts with screening. All patients greater than the age of 18 years old are screened for sepsis. Sears criteria means that they exhibit two or more of the Sears criteria itself. Sepsis is Sears criteria and a confirmed or suspected source of infection. Organ dysfunction, hypotension, increased creatinine, decreased platelets, increased INR, increased lactate, increased bilirubin. To go and progress to septic shock, it's two or more Sears criteria and a confirmed or suspected infection, and one end organ dysfunction. The components of the three-hour bundle are two sets of blood cultures prior to receiving antibiotics from two separate sites. A lactic acid that's drawn, broad-spectrum antibiotics at first, but then tailored to the source of the infection later, and IV fluids running at 30 cc's per kilogram. This is regardless of the person's hemodynamic status. In other words, no matter if the person has congestive heart failure or if they are a hemodialysis player, they should still receive the 30 milliliters per kilogram IV fluid bolus. After the three-hour bundle is completed, we progress on to the six-hour bundle. The focused exam by the MD or the advanced practitioner, APN or PA, including assessment of volume status and tissue perfusion, read by a CVP or an SVO2 or central line access. Vasopressors for persistent hypotension uncorrected by IV fluids would be given, and repeat lactate, however, initially if it's greater than 2 millimoles per liter. This concludes the lecture and review of sepsis for critical care, and I thank you for your attention.